Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. I'm the RPG Chick, and, well, we're back to the die roll again. This is a series where you leave your votes on what, to do at the end of the story and continue on to the next video. But in the case of a tie, in which this case there were only two people who voted and both of them said different things, we have to resort to random chance. So I'm going to roll a d4. 1 and 2 will be the answer for the, this is the answer for Slangg. The wish, because we answered his question correctly, we got a wish from Slangg. The god of something or other. So, 1 and 2 will be my wish is to know who is Vic. 3 and 4, I wish to be rich. What's the exact words? I wish to be rich beyond my imagination. All right. So, throw it. We got two. Who is Vic? So we will find out who Vic is. Hopefully it'll be something that we don't already know about Vic. Okay. Okay. So we answered the question right. It was Sorcery. It was one of our clues. I actually found it. This thing is glitching out. Okay, I don't think you guys can see it, but the glitch was real. Let's see what happens. There's our Vic for First Noble. He's a werewolf. The answer to the question has never been asked. Sorcery. That music is very loud. So, he answers. I gotta read all this again. He turns to you and bows his head once. You are truly blessed. Please, what is your wish? Now, we already know the order of the spell lines, we just don't know the second half of, was it Korga? Not Korga. Mulas. Mulas is spell line. Korga might know the answer. But we already know the order. And, yeah. There were other, possible things. I wish to be stronger, I wish to be rich, but that didn't work out. Who is Vic? You ask. The priest closes his eyes to confer with his god. When he answers, it is another voice entirely. The one they call Vic was once a comrade of the hero Glandragor. Now he owns a slaving ring. Soon he will be first noble, a slaving ring. Right. A gasp goes up from the assembled crowd. These words are clearly sedition. The priest opens his eyes, looking as surprised as everyone else, and raises his hand. The god has spoken, he declares. Vic for First Noble. You thank him. The crowd reach out to touch your tunic as you make your way to the door. Clearly not many survive the challenge of Slangg. Back on the street, it is night. Time to find somewhere out of rest. Should we? The only option is to head for the docks, so I don't know if there's a place to rest there, but got a new clue. Glandragor and Vic were comrades together at once. Okay. Alright, so we're gonna head for the docks. That's all we can do, man. You return to the docks. Yes, we have options. You still need to find somewhere to stay the night. Okay, it really wants us to stay somewhere for the night. So let's... We have some gold. We can sit by the river, sleep in the market, or go to the Wayfarer's Rest, or sleep in an alley. Do we have money to sleep? Can I get out of here if I don't have enough money? I mean, 12 gold isn't that much, but... You make your way inside the Wayfarer's Rest. It is a lively and bustling place. This is a long chapter, guys. I get the first chapter was over in like 5 or 6 episodes. The innkeeper behind the bar is trying to serve numerous creatures all demanding ale at the same time, while around the tables, salty types and buxom wenches are laughing together and singing shanties. I sound like a witch. Okay, we got a table or the bar. This laughing is funny. Let's go to the bar. Let's sidle up to the bar here. You fight your way through the creatures to the bar. With a thump on the bar top, you catch the innkeeper's attention. Let's look him over. The innkeeper is a surly, bald-headed man, used to dealing with the rabble from the docks. He runs his place like a schoolteacher, controlling an unruly classroom. Eyes everywhere, hands quick at collecting money and keeping others out of the till. "Greetings," you say. "Nice place you have here." The innkeeper nods at you. He's clearly impressed by your dress and well-educated tone.
"And what be your purpose in these here parts?" he asks.
The other creatures at the bar jostle and push each other for space. Sure, why not? Let's ask him about the North Gate. See what he has to say. "I'm heading for the North Gate." "Look," the innkeeper replies, cutting you off.
"I didn't mean I wanted to know. I meant, you want a drink? Here I am. You want to talk? And that's what my customers are for."
He waves around the room at the hordes of drunken sailors and other ruffians who fill the space.
"Hmm.
Tell me the price of your ale." The innkeeper holds up one finger. A ruffian knocks over a dwarf's mug of ale. The fight that breaks out is short, and ends with the heel of an axe breaking the ruffian's nose. A great cheer goes up and the innkeeper replaces the ale free of charge. Ask the price of a room. "How much is a room?" you ask. The innkeeper holds up 4 fingers rather than shouting across the bar. "How much is food? Or am I just buying food?" "Can you feed me in this hellhole?" you asked. The innkeeper nods. "Aye. To the gills for 6 gold pieces, hearty as you like." "I'm going to pass on that. How about some ale in a room?" "I'll have a mug then," you declare. You down a coin, and the innkeeper passes you a flagon. "Drink the ale." "I got stamina? Or I lost stamina? I don't even know." You knock tankards with the creatures on either side of you, then drain the beer in one swoop. It is nutty and pleasant, and fills your stomach with a pleasing warm glow. "Finest in Kharé," the innkeeper remarks, seeing your satisfied smile. "Ain't nothing that beats a good glass of Wayfarer's Ripe. You should have another, too. A second's always better." "Nah, it's okay, I'll just get a room." You hand over 4 gold pieces. For a moment, the attention of every other creature at the bar is distracted by the shine. Then the innkeeper slips the coins into his belt, and conversation resumes. He jerks a thumb to the staircase in one corner. "Go up whenever you like." "Okay. Then we will..." "A room is 4. Yeah. If I get something to eat, it's going to be almost all my money, so... Let's head away from the bar." You push your way back out of the crowd at the bar. An angry dwarf in one corner suddenly leaps to his feet, shouting, "Enough talking then. Let's show the council what we think of them now." Okay, if I'm going to be cut off from going to my room since I paid for it, I'm going to end up rewinding, guys, just so you know. But let's go over to the dwarf and see what's going on. You make your way over to the group of dwarves in the corner, who are still arguing loudly about something. "Greetings. May I join you?" The dwarves look up at you with craned necks and deep frowns. "And who are you?" "Yeah, that would be a mistake to say I'm from the council. I'm a traveler." "I'm new to this city." The dwarf nods. "Then you're welcome." He slaps the bench beside him. "Sit down, and I'll tell you why we should burn the council building down tonight." And sit down. You take a seat. "As I was saying," the dwarf continues, "the council are ruining this city, and it's time we took the fight to them. Who's with me?"
"I don't know, Sacksmith. Another replies more sheepishly. After all, things aren't that bad around here. Saxmuth turns to you. And what do you say? Is it run by villains? It is, kind of, isn't it? I mean, everyone on the council, except for the guy, the blind beggar. I felt bad for him. But the other guy, Lorag, was going to make me into his pet for the rest of my life. The other guy, Mulas, is a walking corpse. And I forget the other guy in the tomb. Oh, he was an okay sort once he got past his whatever was in there. Kharé doesn't seem like a fine city either. But there are good people within it. So for that, I'm going to say Kharé seems to be a fine city. The council do a good job in a difficult circumstance. Ha! Saxmuth laughs. The council do nothing at all. Why, no one's even seen them outside their hovel in weeks. Well, the sheepish dwarf says, what would you do? A light gleams in the dwarf's eye. I know where the council is. My father helped dig it, see? Dig? You heard me. I'll take you. On one condition, when we get there, you help me split the first noble's skull. It's time Sansa's lost his crown. And he laughs. There must be another way. Saxma shakes his head. There's no mercy they would show us. He bangs the table with a fist. I'm going now. I paid for a room. Let's go with him and see what happens. I'll bring my sword, you declare, getting to your feet. I'm with you. Saxmuth claps you on the back and heads for the door. Hopefully we can come back and get our room after this. Saxmuth marches away down the dock, and you hurry after him. He will lead you to the council, and perhaps the city nobles themselves. They may even be persuaded to open the way for you if you learn the importance of your mission. If they learn the importance of your mission. Well, we've met all the nobles. How do you plan to attack? The tower is built on several levels, the dwarf replies, whispering in case the empty street should overhear. I suggest we start at the top and make our way down. How will you reach the top? You ask, puzzled. He frowns at you. That part will be the easy part. I'll walk in like anyone else. So where is the council? You don't know? The dwarf replies, generally surprised. You're new in town, then? Just tell me where it is. The council tower is the tallest building in Kharé, but also the best hidden, he replies. I know where it is because I'm a dwarf. You climb a small rise. Below you, the lights of the city port are going dark. I can only abandon the mission now. I have to abandon the mission. I have no other option for some reason. Abandon this mission. Huh. Okay. I guess because I've already found out everything, the game's like, no, you don't have to do this. You're beginning to think better of this mission, and whether he can lead you to the council is in doubt. You already have no idea where you are. You stop in your tracks. Your mission is a fool's one. You'll be killed, and I will not die with you. You return to the docks. It is getting late. Can I go back there? To the room? I can. You return to the docks. You are running out of options. You return to the Wayfarer's Rest to make good on the room you paid for. You head up the stairs to the room above the inn. Excellent. The room is small but clean. You lie down on the bed, tired from your day of walking through the busy city. Eat something? Didn't I just recently eat something? Let's just sleep. I just ate something right before I came to the docks. Or before I came to Slangg's temple. Then it is time to sleep. You close your eyes, and the noise from the downstairs does not trouble you for long. Your dreams are cluttered and crazy. Red-eyed beings loom at you. You seem to be walking forward, traps springing at your feet. Face after face laughs as you ask about the spells. 4, says one. There are 11 spells. 13. 49. Meanwhile, the ghost of Lorag laughs and chortles. I have you right where I want you, he exclaims gleefully. And somewhere beneath your feet, you hear a man cackling with laughter, and the crown is on his head, beyond your reach. So yeah, about Lorag. We meet him. Well, first we meet his ghost by the north gate. Then we meet him at his mansion, and somehow he's still alive. And if we put the green wig or the green helmet or cap or whatever it is on, he turns us into his pet for all eternity, or for the rest of our life anyway. So who's to say we can trust the ghost of Lorag? And why is Lorag alive and has a ghost? Could've found my mouse pointer. Next morning, dawn breaks and you head downstairs. The inn looks like a whirlwind has passed through it. Chairs are turned over on top of tables, plates and flagons have been scattered around, and several patrons are passed out asleep on the floor. Check that they're alive. You stop by the first of the fallen drinkers and check that they're still breathing, which they are. But their breath is so thick and alcoholic it makes you swoon to smell it. You pick your way across the bodies to the door and go out into the street. We are gorilla now. As the sun breaks over the... Ooh, almost full. As the sun breaks over the rooftops of Lower Kharé, the city looks clean and bright, like a stone polished to a shine by a fast-flowing river. The effect lasts for a beautiful moment, and then the people of Kharé begin to stir, opening their windows to throw out their slop, shouting and cursing at each other as they do so. Nice. Did I say the people here were really, really good people? Let's head for the bridge. Trying to make our way for the exit, and I hope I can ask Kurga the remaining spell line. Or the remaining spell of Mulas. The market traders begin to set up their stalls, fighting and threatening each other to get the spots closest to the ships. A few sly types, probably pickpockets, begin to prowl the shadows between the stands. That's not good. Buy breakfast? You wander the stalls looking for something to eat, and find a stand selling bamba bread for 2 gold pieces. The smell is quite nourishing. I only have 1 ration right now, so I'm going to buy some. Oop. Oh. I guess I ate it too? Alright, well at least we're full on stamina. You buy a slice of the bread. It is pleasantly filling, with a sweet, meaty texture. You thank the woman at the stall, then head over to the river to wait for the bridge to be lowered. After a while, a grizzled old man arrives and unlocks a small booth by the harbor bridge. He goes inside and closes the door behind him. Let's knock on the booth. Impatiently, you go over to the booth and knock firmly on the door. The old man lowers down the window and leans out of the booth. What you want? Good morning, you begin cheerfully. Ha, the man replies. Beautiful day, isn't it? The man peers at you suspiciously. Whatever it is, he grumbles. I'm not buying. I'm not selling anything. Not to me, the man replies. He goes back inside his booth. Are you the one who's gonna lower the bridge? You wait another half hour, enjoying the morning sunlight playing on the river. It feels like the first rest you have had since you left the outpost settlement. It's hard to imagine that. Had it not been for the Archmage and the Birdman, you would never have made this journey. Never explored the world outside the Shamutanti Wall. I had a pretty good rest in that town outside. And after that, I think we slept by a river. And that then we met that Divin, or whatever the hell it is. That mischievous fairy-type creature. Who was so annoying because we couldn't cast magic while he was around. Look around the dock? You look around the dock. By the base of the bridge, you notice a winch-like contraption. Perhaps it lowers the bridge? Let's try it. Better than parting with our gold and bribing this guy to lower it. You go over to try the winch. It is extremely heavy, but with a little effort you manage to get it to turn, and sure enough the bridge begins to move slowly down. The old man more or less explodes from his booth and charges over to you. Do you know what you're doing? He demands, apoplectic with rage. You're crazy.
What's the problem?
You ask.
The tide, he retorts. The tide is on my chart. Gotta follow the chart.
He waves a document at you. Vic'll have my skin.
Who's Vic?
You ask.
You don't know?
The man replies with clear surprise.
Vic's going to be ruler of this city soon enough. Mark my words.
Vic for first noble, so they say. And he taps the side of his long nose meaningfully. Then he sighs.
Oh, but I guess it's not far off time. Though I don't like doing things early, not even by a whisker.
The old man leaves his booth and goes over to the contraption on the waterfront. He begins to heave and wind on an ancient winch. The same winch we were working with? It seems to be quite hard work. He is trying to move the whole weight of the bridge single-handedly. Let's help him out.
You get to your feet and go over to help the man out.
Garoff, he growls. You bracket.
All right, don't help.
You let the man struggle, happy to let him be stubborn. Sweat beads on his forehead, and he heaves and pulls as he works, but eventually the bridge clunks down into place. You salute the man cheerfully and get to your feet.
Excellent, we'll go across.
Well, a second time across, crossing this. The first time was against our will. You cross the bridge over the river Jabaji, which runs like a slime trail through the center of the city.
Brilliant.
The other side. You have reached the banks of Upper Kharé. Again. The buildings here are not as grand as on the south side of the river, but they're in much better condition.
So it's south that way?
So, yeah, that makes sense. North Gate. It's just we're moving across the screen, it makes me think east and west. The building, oh yeah, fewer people live on this side. Well, they'll be in much better condition, right? Fewer people live on this side, away from the fields and the hills, but those that do are richer. They are also likely more dangerous. But of course, it is on this side of the city that the North Gate stands.
Correct.
You follow the road away from the river towards a fork in the road. If there are any nobles still in the city port, their houses are most likely to be on this side of the river. But which way?
So let's see if we can make it to the North Gate in this episode. We can only go one way, which is a fork in the road.
We've been that way, we can tell. That would be east. The sun is rising over the streets of Upper Kharé. A few creatures roam this way and that, unaware that they have walked these streets in just this fashion once before.
Right, because we rewinded.
In one corner, a spring bubbles with fresh water.
Let's save it in case I can come back here, because we're full of stamina. This is going to max. I don't think it's going to max. Let's try it.
You cup your hand to the water and drink a mouthful. It is fresh and invigorating. Here, max, and go on. Look around.
Looking left, the road heads into a residential area that seems well cared for. A short way off to the right is an open plaza.
You stop a passing creature. Excuse me, I need to ask you. The creature's head is bowed, and it doesn't look up, but it pulls itself free and hurries away. It is too miserable to speak. There is nothing for it. You will have to explore for yourself.
Now, as far as I can tell, I don't think we've been this way.
To the left, so we'll go to the left, to the left. You follow a narrow, winding street past shops and stalls. It is still early, and they are not yet open, but there are stirrings from within the houses as the day's activities begin. A face appears at one window and seems to watch you pass, although the creature's eyes are closed, and you are not sure that it actually notices you.
Wave?
You wave to the creature, but it does not react. Its eyes are still closed. Another similar creature stands in a doorway across the street, washing themselves from a bucket. This one is thin and spindly, with a long face, not exactly a human, and not an elven either, but something in between.
Read it.
For all I know, I've done this already, I just don't remember. You try to greet the washing creature, but it too has its eyes closed. Perhaps it is soaping its hair and doesn't want to get sting in its eyes. At the end of the road, under a low arch, A group of youths are loitering, talking and kicking stones into the gutter. They notice you and begin to point and talk amongst themselves. Look them over. You pause to look at them. They, too, have their eyes closed, although somehow they have seen you. Or perhaps they have only heard you? Approach? Yeah, I don't remember this. A group of children doesn't scare you. You continue down the street towards them. They fan out a little until they fill the width of the narrow road. Above you, shutters are closing, and people move away from windows as though, despite their eyes, they have seen a fight coming. Close my own eyes? Thinking quickly, you close your eyes. Perhaps you'll be able to blend in. Then you stride forwards into the midst of the group, stumbling slightly and feeling your way. The youths begin to laugh at you. Another blind man? The last one that come through here said he was a noble. Are you a noble too? Which way did he go? You ask quickly, wondering if the youth is talking about Lord Theta. The youth shrugs. Out into the wasteland where they all go to die. We don't let them live with us. We don't like tramps. Let's keep working forwards. You take another few steps forward. You are right in their midst now, and you can feel them clustering in on either side of you. I think this creature is brave, the youth remarks loudly, his voice right by your ear. Shall we take a look at him? There's nothing to see, you reply. Leave him, one of the other youths says. He's not worth anything. You reach the far side of the group and stride smartly away. Well, you could have gotten 5 gold pieces. Let's continue. A short way along, the street forks. A narrow alley heads right between narrow buildings, while the main road curves away out of sight towards a wooded cliff. I remember this area, I think. Let's follow the road, because we're trying to get to the main gate. I hear dogs. You follow the road as it curves around. To your left, a line of buildings has been constructed out of the side of a natural cliff face. Above them is a thick area of trees. On the right, you pass a building bordered by a wall almost as high as itself. Look up into the trees. I think we've been here. Did you see something move between the pines that line the ridge? You stop and stare, but make out nothing. Perhaps a movement of a low shadow. Perhaps it is the sunlight through the shifting branches. But certainly those trees must be thick with wild animals, and the creatures that live here must be plagued by them, unless the creatures that live here are more dangerous themselves. Look at the high wall. Turning about, you crane your neck to look at the wall. It is several times your height. Whoever lives here is keen to keep the inhabitants of Kharé out, or keen perhaps to keep whatever is inside in. The surface is rough and pockmarked with age. At the very top, something gleams. Alright. I'm tempted to think this is Lorag's? But wasn't Lorag... I think this is, the abandoned... I think this is Shinva's mansion? Shut up, you mongrel. I don't remember. That's the problem with rewinding. I don't know if I've been here before. Although we should be able to tell, right? Where am I again? I am here. I've been along here. This is... I'm pretty sure this is... Lorag's. So let's go in there. Something's gleaming on there. Something we can get, right? Giant form? Where's my thing? Giant form. Big. Like, they make it... I should be able to remember this, right? You cast a spell, inflating from your boots to your neck until you are 3 times your normal size. You're now at about as high as the wall itself. Look at the gleam. You peer down at the gleam on top of the wall. It is a small yellow jewel, not gold, and probably not valuable. Let's get it. You pick it up anyway, to find it is a sun jewel. This is an extremely lucky find. Sun jewels are rare and highly valuable. Probably not valuable. You drop it carefully into your pack. Then the spell fades and you shrink back down to your normal size, the wall towering above you once again. Can I cast it again? The sun jewel is for a spell. And for all I know, I've gotten this before as well. We did lose a few things from that gnome. I think it was a gnome. Down in the fallen quarter. The wastelands, whatever you call it. So he might have taken that. Sun jewel. Jewel of gold. Oh, that's jewel of gold. I know there's a sun jewel. I might have looked right at it. Sun jewel. Light spell. That's for a light spell. I'm pretty sure we found this before. Can we cast the spell again? Big? I do have a lot of stamina. You cast the spell a second time, growing tall once again. Vault up onto the wall. You put your hands on top of the wall and pull yourself up. You notice various metal spikes under your palms, but they are not sharp enough to puncture your hide-like skin. From your position, perched on top of the wall, you have a pretty good view into the yard beyond. Do I have time to look at the yard before we shrink down again? You look across the wall into the yard. The building beyond the wall is several stories high and has iron bars across its windows. Guards patrol around outside, all with their eyes closed. But there are no visible prisoners. It seems the souls who are locked up here are not allowed to exercise. Okay, I'm going to leave off here. What do you think? Should I drop down to the other side? I'll probably have to fight these guards. I mean, I do have stamina. But I don't know what's going on. Yeah, that is a mystery, isn't it? With the people who walk around with their eyes closed. Even the boys. And then berate me, saying I'm another blind person. They're not blind then, which means they see in some other way. I don't know. So, yeah. This time, only 2 options for votes. Should I drop down to the other side, deal with the guards, who can probably see me anyway, because the boys with their eyes closed could see me? Or should I just, never mind, drop back down to the street, head back to the North Gate and, you know, just forget about this whole area. So yeah, leave your comments in the section below, guys, and yeah. Next episode might be the last, and we only have 2 more chapters to go. So thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode, and endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.